Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Commodity TV and another edition of our online interview series. And with me here for the first time today is David Stein, the CEO of Kuya Silver. David, good morning. How are you?
I'm well, thanks. Thanks for having me, Jochen.
Yeah, great that you have taken the time. Thank you very much. Kuya Silver, very interesting company. And I must also say that I'm a shareholder of the company, just for disclosure reasons here. What is the company about? Maybe you give us just a short overview, please.
Sure. We're based in Canada. Our principal asset is the Bethania Silver Mine in Peru. So we're we're listed on the CSE. Ticker symbol is KUYA, and so we're looking to put our mine into production. It's on care and maintenance, and become a silver producer as quickly as possible. And most importantly, we intend to make a very big profit on it.
Of course. This is why we are shareholders, right? Yeah. Okay. Let's dive into it. The Bethania Silver Mine is your key asset, I would call it. And as you already said, it is a historical mine. So it was in production again, already, not again. And you want to bring it again in production. Of course, what I'm interested in, what might it cost to bring in production? I know this is a forward-looking statement, but just hypothetically, what we are talking about, what is the situation today, and when do you think you can start production?
Sure. This is a great start. So the mine was producing actually until 2016 as a toll milling operation. So they would mine this very high-grade silver polymetallic ore and then have it trucked to all over the place to have it processed. And our plan is really to do an expansion right now. So we're expanding the throughput, but more importantly, we're going to install our own process plant. So we'll be able to produce concentrate at site and then sell it. And by doing that, we reduce the trucking costs, we reduce the processing costs, and we increase our recoveries for all the metals, especially silver, the most important one. So that's the plan. Now, internally, our own management estimate, we don't have a PEA or a feasibility study at the moment, but our management estimate is that this whole expansion project will cost about $10 million US to build. So that includes the plant itself, the underground development, the tailings, everything like that. And we will be basically looking to construct that over next year, 2021, and commission towards the end of the year. We're going to start off with a relatively small high grade, a small tonnage, plant, produce the high grade silver at a very low cost. And then as the years go on, as we go forward, we'd look to expand it, but the idea is get into production quickly, make a lot of money, cash flow doing that. And then we can always expand it later.
Okay, so what do you think the processing rate shall go up to 350 tons per day, if I'm correct, right? Yes. And what makes you so sure that you have enough material? As you said it, you have not done any 43-101 or stuff like this. So what makes you so sure that you really have enough material that you can process and then you can restart drilling, of course, again?
Right. So while we don't have a resource 43-101 resource estimate, we do have a 43-101 technical report, by the way, you have to list, and that is available if anyone wants to read it online. But we have a tremendous amount of underground data from the historical mining that took place until a few years ago. So it's very recent information. It's high quality. I mean, we're talking about thousands of samples along, basically seven veins that we can access underground. And sampling allows us to, at least internally, get a strong comfort that there is resources there for the next several years. And then from there, we'll go to a drilling program, which we will be starting very soon. And we'll look to confirm that and then ultimately grow the resource as well. We feel like, we can easily grow the resource over time, and we'll be drilling to do that from now on. So the previous owners, the way that they explored was basically just doing tunnels underground, and we can use that.
They're fully in operation, those tunnels,
right? Yeah, they were. Yeah. There's 6 kilometers actually of horizontal workings along 7 different veins. in the mine at the moment, and at different levels. So we've got, you know, so we've got basically three dimensions of these various veins. But you know, going forward, we're going to sort of transition to more of a, you know, I guess Canadian style or, you know, of exploration, where we're going to be doing drilling from surface and eventually underground.
Okay, super. Can you tell us already something about, let's say, possible grades or grab samples you had, or whatever you have done, some test samples you have taken so far? Because I'm pretty sure you have done something before, because you're not doing this out of the blue, right?
Right. Well, in fact, I think, you know, we've got even better than that. We've actually got mining head grades from a few years ago that were averaging around 15 ounces per ton silver.
Okay.
Plus multi-percent lead and zinc.
Now nice byproducts.
Mm-hmm. Right. You've got nice byproducts. Now there's also copper and gold in the ore, but they never got paid for that before, because they were milling the ore at other lead zinc mines in the area. Mm-hmm. So they didn't have the capability of recovering the copper and the gold. So we will be able to do that when we have our own plant. You know, it's not huge, but it's worth doing, and it's, you know, basically free money for us. So we're going to do that as well. But you know, the silver grades, we're very confident that we'll get, you know, something around there. And when you extrapolate that over 350 tons per day, you know, and this is just basic math that anyone can do, you get about, you know, just under 2 million ounces of pure silver ounces per year. And then if you look at it on an equivalent silver equivalent basis, it's well over 2 million.
Mm-hmm, yeah, exactly. That would be also one of my questions. So we talk about pure silver, not silver equivalent so far, because I think this is very important for the economic metrics.
Right. And look, I first and foremost, you know, I come from the investment side. And one of the things that would bug me a lot is if people try and sell me a silver mine, and then you actually go through and say, oh, this is mostly zinc or mostly lead or whatever. Yes. Right. So we know with our mine, it's going to be, depending on the other metal prices, 60, 65% silver. Mm-hmm. So it is a true silver mine, primary silver mine, with byproducts. And then, for me, that's very important. And, you know, cause, silver is going to be our focus for the company, even beyond Bethania going forward.
Okay, super. I saw also in your presentation a beautiful slide with AISC. You are targeting, it looks to me like $10, $11 around. This is what I saw on the graph. Right. And also there was a lot of optimization possibilities in it. Can you please go into a bit more detail? How do you want to achieve that?
Sure. Well, you know, it's worth mentioning that, you know, because again, we have the financial results from the company, the mining company that we're buying. Mm-hmm. So if you go back to the last full year of production, which was 2015, the AISC was $16.30 an ounce. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just if you look at some of the public companies out there, their costs are actually way higher than that. However, that's toll milling, and we can do much better than that by having our own plant. So the plant is going to reduce costs through a number of ways. As I mentioned before, trucking basically goes to zero, the trucking costs. We don't have to pay the premium to toll mill now. We'll just pay the direct costs, of course. We get better recoveries because the mill's set up for our ore instead of someone else's.
Okay.
And then we also get, you know, we think, you know, again, by selling our a larger amount of concentrate, we're going to get better terms. The mm-hmm. concentrate market's actually better than it was 5 years ago. Mm-hmm. So there's a number of factors that cause that cost to go down. So we're targeting around $11 AISC internally, and we should be able to confirm that over the next year as we mm-hmm. move the project forward.
Mm-hmm. Super. Also, I saw an interesting chart with the graphs of the silver price, and then like there was first Majestic and Endeavor Silver in Great Panda. So it looks to me a little bit like that the idea of Kuya is to lay like a foundation stone or rock, if you want to use that term, with the Bethania mine for a much larger silver, or let's say secondary primary silver producer, like to become a senior company, like in the good tradition of Fortuna Silver, for example. Is that the case?
Yeah, that is the case. And that's the case. You know, that's the point I sort of make with some of those slides in the presentation, mm-hmm. is that, you know, what we're doing with Bethania, you know, I don't think it's been done recently, but it's not also a new idea, which is that you basically get into production with a kind of a starter operation, like what we're doing. And then you can grow the company from there. And there, you know, there's so few true silver mining companies out there for the market. You know, it's a tremendous opportunity for us and for our shareholders. You know, if you go back a few years, you look at, you know, the early days of First Majestic, this is exactly what they did in Mexico. You know, they started off with kind of a small high grade mine, and they sort of got the public company valuation based on that first mine. And then they repeated the formula again and again. And even going back even further to the mid 90s, Pan American Silver actually started in our backyard in Peru with the Caravelca mine. That was their first producing mine. And that's really what got Pan American going as a silver company, you know. And now, you know, here we are 25 years later, and they have like a, you know, huge multi-billion dollar market cap, as does First Majestic. So I think it's a great way to start a company. And that's what we're looking at doing. We're looking at building a company for the long term here. And Bethania is a great starting asset.
Okay, super. So how is the situation, let's say, with permitting? Because as far as I understand, in Peru, you can have a small scale mining license up to those 350 tons per day. But if you want to go higher, I think you need, again, a permitting process, correct?
Well, it wouldn't be a new permit if we were to go beyond 350 tons per day. It's more of sort of an amendment type process. We do move to what's called the general regime in Peru, from the small miner regime. And look, we're already planning to do that. We're going to do that seamlessly while we're already in production. That's okay. The plan. So, From the point of view of, you know, of the shareholders, you know, we'll be sort of producing, making money while all this is happening in the background, mm-hmm. and, you know, we'll be able to do it and then expand, you know, in the next couple of years once we have, you know, done enough exploration to justify it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then you know, on the drilling side, I'll just mention that's another thing that some of the junior companies have trouble with in Peru. We're very fortunate because we have the permitted mine. That you know, basically we're allowed to drill on our mine property, so we'll be able to do a drill program very shortly, really without any concern on the permitting side.
Okay, super. You just said shareholders. That's also very interesting with your company, because management has a huge chunk of the company. Who are your other big shareholders? And of course, what is cash in the bank? Because you said you will use $10 million here to really build this up.
Yeah. Okay. Great question. So we have a number of institutions that came in either, you know, at towards the end of us being a private company in the final round of being private, or our RTO financing round that we did back in June, July of this year. Mm-hmm. So one of those is Commodity Capital, you know, based in Canada, but has some ties to Europe, mm-hmm. who you may know.
I know Tobias very well.
Right. So they're the second largest shareholder after myself. And then we've got Eric Sprott as a shareholder. Now, he actually invested earlier when we were private. So that was great. He's one of our first big sort of outside investors to come into the company as a private company. Mm-hmm. And then below 5%, let's say, we've got a handful of probably, six or eight other, you know, institutions below 5%. So we've got, you know, it's a good base, but, you know, obviously, just a very small handful of larger shareholders at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Fantastic. So, and what is cash in the bank by now?
About 12 million, after we did the financing, RTO, you know, we still have about 12 million. Yeah.
Okay. Super. So would that be enough to really start production?
No, we still have to pay the final, acquisition costs for the mine. Mm-hmm. So, you know, a good chunk of that cash, about 5 million or so is going to go Canadian is going to go towards that, that cost. And we are buying 100% now instead of 80. When we did the RTO originally, it was, we were only buying 80% of the mine, but, you'll see in our recent press releases, we have a deal now to buy 100%. So that's going to consume, you know, a good chunk of our cash. And then the rest, we're going to be doing, the drill program, finish the engineering, detailed engineering work for the mine. So the actual CapEx for the expansion, you know, we kind of internally or think of that as a, you know, as a separate financing that will, you know, will happen, you know, when we're ready to do it. And, you know, I don't expect it to be too much trouble. It's a small, relatively small amount, and there's lots of interest for it. So we will tackle that, you know, in the next several months.
Mm-hmm. Okay, super. Last question. If you would have to say in 2-3 points, what differentiates your company from the rest of the silver universe?
I think, you know, given our size, you know, and our market cap at the moment, you know, what differentiates us is the fact that we're really set up to go into production, you know, from everything from the management, you know, down, we've been focused on production as a private company, permitting, and engineering, doing engineering work. And, you know, now that we're public, it's you know, it's going to actually be a lot easier to get there in terms of the access to capital. So we're really set up to go into production. You know, it's a quick timeline, you know, that we feel that we can meet, you know, producing in early 2022, commissioning the mill at the end of next year. Mm-hmm. And I think that's very, very different. I'm not sure there's really anyone like us out there who have the, you know, sort of the combination of advancing a project to production in the next year, while at the same time, we'll be doing lots of drilling and we'll be expanding the resource and we'll be doing, you know, sort of all the other stuff that every other junior does, except that we're at the end of the day, you know, a year from now or thereabouts, we'll be producing silver.
Fantastic. That was a great final sentence. Thank you very much, David, for the insight. And I have a feeling that we talk a lot more in the future here, because there's really a lot of good things going on with you guys. And hopefully you are like in 15 to 18 months latest in commercial production.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Super. Thank you very much, David.
Thank you.
Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, that was David Stein, the CEO of Kuya Silver, and you heard it, quite a new company. It was created through a reverse takeover. The company has $12 million cash in the bank. They are just in the final buy event, I would say, for the Bethania mine to get 100% of the mine. Also already they have inherited a lot of technical data. They can use over 6 kilometers of tunnels, which are really ready to work in. And they want to install their own processing plant. And what I think is really key to success here, that they can process then really all the metals they have in the mine. Approximately 65% of that is silver, pure silver, in addition, lead, zinc, but also copper and gold. And if they can achieve those 10 to 11, maybe $12 AISC, that would be a very profitable production in 15, maybe 18 months. Let's be conservative. If it's faster, even better. And I would suggest you really check out the company. We see it heavily undervalued and see a lot of more value here. And what we really appreciate is that management has a huge chunk in the company, so they are fully aligned with shareholders. Thanks for watching us, and bye-bye from Switzerland.